Bullshit. Oh, it happens.
You can't use it on yourself.
Oh, okay.
Recording has started. All right, yeah, so we are live. So to recap what happened, it's because it's been a couple weeks since we got to last play. You guys were traveling through a forest and woke up after spending the night in that forest in a different one. And it was strange. The skies were overcast, and as you kind of wandered around, you found a road that led to a village full of dilapidated houses. As you kind of searched through the village, you saw two children in the road, and they told you that there was a monster in their house and that they wouldn't go back in. And as you kind of start to investigate the entrance of that house, you noticed that the ever-present fog started to roll in kind of ominously from every direction and surround the house, basically forcing you inside. At that point, you explored the first two floors, which were like really well furnished, and noticed several carvings in the walls and doors that were far more sinister than they first appeared. When you reached the third floor, the house suddenly became as dilapidated as the rest of the houses on the street, and the floorboards creak, and there's cobwebs and dust everywhere. You searched through the rooms, fought a ghost, fought a broom, and eventually found a set of secret doors behind a set of dresser drawers with a mirror, or it was just a mirror, I can't remember. But it slid back to reveal stairs going up to an attic. And I will let you guys decide what to do from there.
So if I recall correctly, did we expend... We had a healer, right?
Me.
And where are we sitting on healing? Who's hurt? I'm not hurt. I know Lauren was hurt.
We did a minor rest of some kind right before we...
And did a short rest and recover...
Yes.
Hit points based off of our...
Yes. Because I was very down before we did that. And that's the last thing we did before we were talking about going into the mirror.
I recall getting healing and then resting.
Yeah. I saved your life. If you were dying, because that broom beat you over the head.
It was a big broom.
Did we do a long rest?
No, we did not. I did not regain spells.
Yeah, no, I think you guys have only had a short rest.
We've already adventured through all of this.
Mm-hmm.
All this lore.
We just got the secrets, the S's, unlocked. Okay.
Shall we head upstairs?
So I have... Just so everyone's aware, I have one spell, and that's it.
We can do a long rest, bunkered out in this room.
Let's see what we can.
Because if we do a long rest,
I would rather be safe than die. I think saving all these guys forever.
I only have so many heals.
Alright, long rest, I guess. We'll,
I can keep watch half the time.
Fortify the door. I'll move the bed in front of the door in the hallway. And maybe we'll barricade the balcony door. And I'll sleep in the fireplace.
What do I want to have you guys do? Alright, I'll let you guys attempt to take a long rest. As you rest during the night, you hear strange sounds throughout the house. Sometimes it might be footsteps, but they seem like they're coming from directions where nobody should be able to walk, like maybe on the outside of the house. The floorboards creak. I would like you guys, as you hear all these strange noises in this creepy ass old house, to make a constitution check. More like a con save to determine whether you actually have a restful night's sleep.
Do I get any modifiers? Because I only need 4 hours.
You can have advantage on it. Since you're not trying to sleep through as much time.
13 for me.
17.
Wait,
what was the roll?
It was con.
18 for me.
Okay.
17 for me.
So if you got above 15, you are well rested again.
And if you didn't?
If you didn't, you don't gain any of the benefits of a long rest, but you don't gain a level of exhaustion for, you know, being up for a long period of time. You're able to fitfully get some sleep, but it wasn't enough to, you know, regain your spells and regain some health.
I regained my spells from a short rest. Took a short rest last time.
Yeah.
So then I get the level two. I get my level two spell, or my add-on spell I get for being level two now.
Yeah.
Chill the pain.
I like the delay.
All right, so who's going up first?
The short guys go up first.
Sure.
I'll be immediately behind you. Within touch range of you, just in case.
Okay. So let's do this.
Just now. I can grant plus 2 AC bonus for a duration of 10 minutes on anyone within 60 feet of me. Digital.
So you have to follow me up the stairs and
talk to that one. Oh, that's for guidance. I was going for my cantrip, so I can add some more to your role.
That's going to be.
Things have an ability check. I can add a few words.
Super thin here. I like this. Oh. Double click on that, it'll maximize it. And then we don't have to look at ourselves.
But that's aiming at ourselves.
Yeah, so I'm feeding you back.
Yeah, we're on one screen.
Move this over for you guys so you can see that. Yeah, you're all on one screen because I'm basically feeding multiple inputs into my video. Yeah, X video. And then I'm feeding X video back to Skype as an input source just so I can record it and have you guys up all at the same time.
Are you streaming it too?
I'm not streaming it, I'm just recording it locally. My upload speed is not sufficient to stream at any decent quality. Let's go, Sandra. So,
that's why I got the off-ranger. So I was like, I'll get one.
The turkey? I like the turkey.
Really? I'm a beef purist, but out of all the turkey stuff, there's the best.
Okay, so you guys make your way up this rickety staircase to the attic. And it has a 90-degree turn. And at the top of the stairs, there is a wooden door.
What's the RGB that you have that pops up every once in a while?
The circles.
What circles?
The red, green, blue circles that were next to the...
Next to the cleric.
Oh, they're like... You can assign like other kind of points to these icons. Like Roll 20 has a much more in-depth ability to handle the game inside itself. Like if we all played at our computers, you could do all the rolls, all the status effects, just about everything could be handled inside the game. And when I click on the icons, there's different like those are red, green, and blue orbs are like things I could assign to you or numbers I could assign to you, stuff like that.
That's kind of cool. I was really impressed with Roll 20 when I looked at it before when we were kind of looking at various things. It seemed to be pretty robust for the platform that it is.
Yeah, it was. It was a lot more robust than what Wizards of the Coast offered as their kind of online solution for 4E until they nixed it while it was still in beta.
Dice rolling thing out of my Warhammer.
I don't have a little bit more.
Sometimes it feels like a dice tower is more of a pain in the ass, though, because I have one.
Good.
I used it. Yeah, my dad did a good job on that.
I really like that one.
But anyway, you're at the top of the stairs with the wooden door. What do you guys do?
Knock. Open. Here's the way.
I'll push the door open from a semi-safe distance with my glaive.
It doesn't move.
I'm going to reach out with Mage Hand, and I'm going to turn the handle. Is it locked?
It's locked.
Anyone like to try to unlock it before I keep it down?
I have no way to.
Yeah.
I have the same as you. I can report.
I don't have a lock. Okay, I'm smashing this thing down.
Nobody wrote down that you guys picked up a key?
Hey, I don't know. We have a key. Why don't we try this key that we have?
Well, next time I'm not reminding you.
We never went downstairs to see if it worked on the...
We didn't on that wardrobe. Not wardrobe, but yeah.
Yeah.
I think the implication here is that it's at least supposed to work on this thing.
Yeah.
I'll take the key from where we're supposed to have that thing and try it on the door.
Okay, so as you insert the key, the trap goes... Oh, no, I'm kidding. The door unlocks.
He electrifies and you die.
So yes, you are able to unlock the door. Do you open it?
I'll push it open with Mage Hand.
So it slowly opens with Mage Hand. You should be able to see to the end up here. So in front of you, I believe you see another door. And a room. Let me look up what that room says.
What are you doing? I know what I do.
It's just a hall that's choked with dust and cobwebs.
Does anyone have any light?
I have light.
I have light.
I can also see the dark.
You have an object if you want to make glow. Do you need the light?
I don't have dust.
What weapon do you have?
I have something called a jammer.
And every session, that's your glaive, and it magically starts glowing with light.
Okay, my glaive is lightified. You want to step into the room one space and then one space to the left?
Okay.
And I'll follow him and I'll move one more space to the left, so pretty much. To the left of where he previously was, south of where he now is.
Like here?
Yep.
Down one? Okay, let me reveal more of the area for you guys.
Can you zoom out a little bit?
Yeah, sure.
I just don't want you to have to, like, constantly be moving the room around, because we can't actually see
what you exposed south of us.
Yeah. Okay. Perfect. I'll come in and stand to the right of Austin.
Alright. And Jason, are you entering the room or are you staying in the hall?
I will enter the room.
Any particular spot?
Go ahead and put me, yeah, that's fine.
Okay.
I'll secure you two of my glasses.
You're polishing your dice?
So I actually think the thing to the north of you is another window. It just looks out into the fog. There's two doors in that sort of hallway to the left. On the north side, on the south side, there's another door. And then farther to the south, there's a door like behind you guys.
Can I take a moment and roll perception to see if I hear any noises?
Sure.
I don't hear any noises.
What'd you roll?
3.
Oh, okay. No, just the sound of the wind outside and the creaking of the house.
I'll blame the creaking of the house. I can't hear over the creaking of this house.
I'm going to investigate that window, see if I can say anything weird about it or out of it.
You don't... No, yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, 14.
14? Now, you don't notice anything unusual about it. It looks out... it might have looked out into a courtyard behind the house, but all you can see now is the ever-present fog outside. You do notice something strange about it, that the, you know, it was one that opened up and down, and it's been nailed shut.
Like that. Can I go test the door to the south?
To the south.
I'll move down one space to be next to him before he tests it.
So what do you mean by testing it? Are you trying to open it a little bit? Are you just turning the knob?
Yeah, just turning the knob.
You don't feel any resistance as you try and turn the knob.
I'd like to clarify which one I am. Am I the one in the blue robes right above?
Okay, yeah.
Perfect.
Yeah, you're the one in blue robes that has a crossbow and magic on the other arm.
Okay, I see the magic now. Makes sense.
Okay. I'll motion to the dwarf that this door is unlocked.
Aren't there two dwarves? Which one?
Yeah. The fighter dwarf.
Blood dwarf. Okay.
Well, I get over to that door, so nothing ambling with us or whatever.
The other one doesn't count, he's a healer.
Yeah. I'm a healer in heavy armor.
Right, very healer now.
It looks like you're in robes.
Alright.
So bad.
What do you do, Austin?
I'm just gonna push the door open so it's open.
Okay.
Ricky Bobby's not a thinker. Ricky Bobby's a doer.
I just don't want to reveal stuff that you guys shouldn't see.
Right.
So you open the door and inside you see this dust-choked room contains a slender bed, a nightstand, a small iron stove, a writing desk with a stool, and an empty wardrobe, and a rocking chair in the corner.
I'll investigate the stove.
I'm having to guess at which one of these pixelated blobs is the stove. I'll say over here.
That's what I'm guessing too.
All right, when you go further into the room, you notice that on the windowsill here, down by where the number 17 is, there is a small smiling doll in a lacy yellow dress sits in the window box, cobwebs draped across it like a wedding veil.
If the character was me, personal me would be to just back it straight out of that room with fucking eyes on it. My character probably would just ignore it.
That's a desk above 17 there?
That's what I guess. That's the desk.
Yeah, I think that's the writing desk, yeah.
Can I investigate the writing desk?
Sure.
With investigation.
Okay.
I'm at 8.
The drawers are empty. There's no paper on it. There's an inkwell with no pen, and the inkwell is dry. It doesn't look like there's ever ink in it.
I'd like to search the desk, look for any hidden compartments or anything.
Okay.
There's only one this flavor. I think the barbecue. Oh, Nina's, yeah.
13.
Same description.
I'm stepping into the middle of the room and assuming a defensive stance before the idiots get themselves killed.
Okay. Oh yeah, you came over here to search the desk. Also, you had to go on the other side. Alright, what else would you guys like to do?
Search the bed, search under it, search around it, search for the mattress, etc.
The bed has simple sheets and a blanket. They're worn with age and they don't look like they've ever been used. There's nothing under the bed. There's nothing, no personal items in the room at all.
Who's the smartest guy in the room? Let's go look at the doll. Will you investigate it?
I will investigate the doll. First, I'd like to use perception on it.
Okay.
Do I notice anything odd about it? Is there...
Wait. Plus 3 to your perception.
Okay, so that's 18.
The doll's leaning slightly forward, like it's leering down at all of you. You notice that the smile is stitched unevenly across its face and ends farther to one side than the other.
Okay, they did their best.
Next to that, is that a dresser?
Yeah.
Some kind of wardrobe.
Yeah, it was a wardrobe, I believe.
Can I check the wardrobe?
Yeah.
9.
It's empty.
Alright, I will do an investigation on the doll. And that's a 20.
How are you investigating it? Like, what are you physically doing as a character?
I'll use Mage Hand to pick it up and turn it around so that I can inspect it on all sides and look for anything.
So, when you cast Mage Hand and it emerges this time, instead of a normal, like, semi-transparent hand, a semi-transparent skeletal hand appears in front of you. It still obeys your commands, and it flies over to the window and picks up the doll, and as you start to rotate it around, the time-worn stitches holding the head to the neck tear apart, and the head just falls to the floor with a soft thump.
Well, first of all, with my arcana, I'd like to know if I can come up with any reasonable explanation why my conjuration would, present itself in such a manner versus what I'm used to.
Think, roll arcana and think about it.
11.
You don't have any idea why that just happened.
Okay. I'm gonna...
Can I roll Arcana on that? I'm actually trained in it.
Yeah, sure. You noticed the same thing. It appeared the same to you.
See? Dice tower. Good. damn it. 15.
So thinking back on some of the tomes that you have read that talk about warlocks traveling through the plains, you recall a fragment of knowledge that sometimes a plane will affect the magic, the form a spell takes when it is cast, and it reflects the nature of the plane that you reside on.
Alright, with Mage Hand, I'm going to poke inside the doll. Do I find anything more than just stuffing on the inside?
No, you don't.
Including inside the head?
Including. I think soft thud was maybe the wrong word. It's, you know, like almost silent cloth plop.
Right.
Walking up the staircase.
Okay, I'm going to resist the urge to step on that doll and tell everyone that we're supposed to, that we should just get out of here.
I'm fine with that. I don't know who's investigated everything in this room.
I'm going to walk over as everyone's leaving the room and nonchalantly pick up the doll and put it in my bag.
The body and the head, the whole thing?
Yeah.
Okay.
Captain Chuck. Stealth it. Roll stealth.
Yeah. I rolled a 2. Okay.
Tell him to leave that thing in here.
It's too late to get back.
So he said he told you you noticed it. You told him to leave it here. That's something you two have to work out.
Anyone else keep on take it?
Yeah, everybody's trying to take the doll. It's trying to get us possessed.
Well, it's been investigated. It's not possessed.
Warlock, you know, not the powers that you trifle with.
You said the guy that sold the soul to the devil.
It's a doll. You guys shouldn't be so chicken shit. How old are you? How old am I? I don't know. Older?
Older? Oldish?
In my mid-20s. I'm a young, strapping lad who knows not to possess dolls.
I'm 28. I'm much older than you.
I'm 200. Yeah, so I don't have any respect for authority.
Okay.
Okay. To avoid a conflict in the haunted house, I'm just going to go along with it.
It's okay, guys.
All right.
We're here to find the parents. That's what we're here for.
Putting you back in the hallway. You can be over here. All right. What would you guys like to do now?
I picked up the doll and it teleported us to the hall.
We're moving things along.
All right.
Now let's turn down the hallway and all that.
Now, what's above 16? That's a door?
It's a door. There's two doors.
Black dot.
I have no idea.
Huh.
Code, Lawrence. It's code. I know. Go in it.
Irresistible urge to walk into the door.
Stand up.
Let's walk into there.
You want to walk into the first door? The one right above 16?
One with the weird dot.
Down that hallway, is that just hallway end there?
Yeah, it just ends in a wall.
Okay. Alright. Line up next to the guy going in the door and go in right behind him.
Okay.
How long would you say investigating each of these rooms is taking us?
For each roll, you're spending a couple minutes looking over something. So in that last room, you maybe spent 20 minutes opening the wardrobe, pulling through the drawers, looking at the inkwell, casting a spell, picking up the doll, trying to, you know, poke around its insides to figure out if there's anything special about it. Looking under the bed, you guys, you know, you investigated a bunch of different things. But I'll say you guys, you know, we do it sequentially, but characters in the game can do it all at once. So like 10, 15 minutes.
Okay.
Giving it a good look over.
That's good.
Don't want to burn any spells too soon.
That's why. Yeah, trips.
Awesome.
Hey, bro. Wait, you got the guides? You need ability switcher? Use your ability switcher.
Is that a cantrip? Mm-hmm. It's one per, what? Round. I mean, yeah, you can always cast one spell around. I mean, so
one concentration, so you can't do it on more than
one. One action, cast time, range, touch, duration 1 minute.
So, I mean, technically, if we'd taken time in that room, you could have done it on everybody for everything.
Yeah.
That's why
So what's in the room, Andy?
All right. So the door to this room doesn't look like the other doors in this house. Well, it looks like the other doors, but there's something extra about it. On the outside, there's a latch and a padlock.
Uh-huh.
It's currently locked as well.
Can we try the key?
Sure. The key also opens that padlock.
Yeah.
So this heavy, you know, ornate padlock opens.
Yeah.
You're able to take it off the latch. The handle seems to move freely after that.
Alright, let's open the door.
Okay.
So these 200, how old are you?
I'm only 53. Oh. I had an issue with authoritative figures. I'm not lawful. I'm good, I'm not lawful. I'm kind of a weird dwarf.
This room contains a bricked-up window flanked by two dusty wood-framed beds sized for children. Closer to the door is a toy chest with windmills painted on the sides and a dollhouse that's a perfect replica of the dreary edifice in which you stand. These furnishings are draped in cobwebs. Lying in the middle of the floor are two small skeletons wearing tattered but familiar clothing. The smaller of the two cradles a stuffed doll that you also recognize.
I'll enter the room.
Yeah.
But I do not want to disturb the skeleton.
That's his pile. It's two small skeletons. They're kind of holding each other. And the smaller of the two is holding a doll.
Can you pull that doll out of your inventory and compare it?
Yeah.
They don't look the same.
Does the one she's holding look like a non-scary version? Or has it also got like a crooked stitched mouth and...
It looks like a slightly odd teddy bear. Just roll a d20 and tell me the result.
All of us are just going.
I'm tired of dice rolling games.
I rolled a 1.
Yeah, that... You don't remember anything about that doll.
Where am I, guys?
I'm gonna take a look at the dollhouse. 18 for investigation.
Investigation?
Yeah.
So you start to... It looks like a very accurate representation of the house. As you start to investigate it, let me put your character by it. What are you doing there? Okay. I'll say this is the dollhouse. As you start to investigate it, your hand brushes against the outside of the dollhouse. And you're focused on it, but as you continue to investigate it, suddenly you notice that, and you couldn't tell exactly when, even though you were kind of looking in that direction as you investigated it towards the center of the room, there now stands two small transparent children. They look just like the ones you saw out in the road in front of this house. The older one looks at you and says, "Don't touch all things."
Ah, oh shit.
Can I address the children?
Yeah.
Can I ask their names? I'll introduce myself. You know, it's like, "Hello, kids. My name is Minder. Who might you be?"
The older one, which is the girl, says that she's Rosalind. And she points to the smaller one and says, "And that's my brother Thornbolt." Those are the same names that you heard outside.
Children, were you the ones outside that asked us to come in and find your parents?
No, we can't leave the house.
Why is that?
Well, our parents locked us up here to protect us from the things in the basement. But one day they stopped checking on us, and we starved and died.
How do you get into the basement?
She points at the dollhouse. There's stairs that lead down. Now roll a perception check.
Hold us.
What's up?
Hold us.
You can, you know, she's saying this out loud, so you're welcome to try and perceive.
I roll a 21.
You now notice that there is a spiral staircase. That leads from the attic to below the house in the representation of the dollhouse. And you know where it would be to locate it in the real house, if it exists.
Can I ask the children if this doll happens to belong to one of them? And I kind of present the doll.
Rose says, "Oh, that used to be my doll when I was growing up, but I just, you know, set it on the windowsill one day and forgot about it. You know, I was growing up to be a lady. Dolls were something that I had to give up." And she, like, kind of looks disdainfully at Thorn, who still has a doll clutched to his chest.
I'll set the doll down next to the dollhouse.
Okay.
Do you children know of a baby from when you were still alive that your father might have held in a picture or in a painting that you were in?
They remember standing for the painting, but they don't remember ever seeing a baby.
I am, unlike everyone else, apparently 100% sick of the room full of dead children. I'm going to go downstairs and find this basement and kill the monster and leave.
You're just going to go downstairs?
Yeah, I'm leaving.
So, Jason, you notice that the stairwell starts in the attic and spirals down.
Alright. So I'm going to go. I'll go to the location where that should be, and I'll look for an opening.
the children what is keeping their spirits trapped on this plane?
They don't know.
Okay.
Alright. So they appear to grow quite agitated when, let me make sure I get the names right. Asandra and Galder, is that your character, Austin?
Yes.
When you two try and leave them, they grow quite agitated. Both of you roll.
One.
You rolled a one?
Yep.
It's rolling a straight roll?
No, I think it's a, it's probably a wisdom. A wisdom saving throw?
I got two.
I had an 18.
Let me double check. But an 18 is probably going to pass no matter what.
I rolled a 15, so.
Okay. Ah. There we go, ghost. Oh, it's a charisma saving throw.
I rolled a 0. I rolled a 16.
Okay. So, Rose attempted to possess you, Asandra, but you were able to resist her, so she seems to be still in the room but unhappy. Galder, Thorn disappears from the room. And you feel a strange presence enter your body. You're still in control of yourself, but you feel strange emotions. You feel scared of everything, including your own shadow, and weep with despair when things don't go your way.
Dude, you're going to work.
I'm no longer so hot about going downstairs. I'm just going to
I'm gonna clap my hands and go, God damn, this just got interesting. Alright, well, I'm gonna mosey on out of the room. I don't have removed child from my body, so.
The ghost is still in there, so you might be able to get it a message if you still want to try and talk to it.
What? No, I'm good. Before I leave the room, I asked why did her brother disappear?
He doesn't want you to leave. He's, you know, neither of us want you to leave. We've been locked in here for so long.
Do you want to just walk with us as we try to help you?
No, we want to stay. We want to stay up here where it's safe.
Sure.
I will apologize to the older sister that we must carry on, but we will do whatever we can in our power to free them from this torment.
So that way they can forever be safe.
Alright, as you make that promise, you're thinking about what might do what you've just said. So go ahead and roll, like, a knowledge religion check.
Religion is intelligence. No, 15.
A 15?
Yep.
Wow.
Uh-huh.
Wow.
You remember that with tormented spirits and ghosts, often the way to put them to rest is to inter their remains somewhere respectful.
Was there any type of...
Let's go to the courthouse out back. Do you want to bury him in this haunted house, though? I say we come back to the bodies. Afterwards.
I am actively possessed.
That's true. So you probably can't think of your own dead body, huh?
I assume we shouldn't, like, burn the bodies in this bedroom. But,
Well, I'll turn to her. What are the burial rituals of your people?
She's too young to know about that.
I'm putting them in the beds. I mean, that would at least be better with where they are.
But they're holding each other.
I don't want to separate them. We'll put them in the big bed in the other room.
It's not.
Is that better?
I don't remember what knowledge history for local burial rituals or whatever.
I do like Jason's idea, though.
You are not from this area, and knowledge of this area does not get to where you are from.
Wasn't there a library downstairs? Like, we were going through, there's books and stuff. There might be something back in the library.
I like Jason's idea. I'm going to pick up the corpses.
Uh-huh.
And take them down into the big bedroom. I'm going to put them in the bed. And I'm just going to tell the children, rest here, children. I will return for you.
It doesn't seem to have any effect.
Okay.
Library, what's our book?
That's
back down on the first floor.
Do we want to spend that time? Do we know if we can explain?
Alright, so, Jason, you know from studying the house that behind this wall right here, at the end of the hallway, is the stairwell that goes down. But as you search that wall, and you search it pretty thoroughly, you do not notice any latch or other kind of opening that would slide open to actually let you get into that stairwell.
Can you move the map over so we can see that wall?
Oh, sure.
Thanks. Oh.
Where you bust the wall down?
I mean, those aren't doorways or something, are they? That's a doorway that we have to find something.
Doorway up and down.
Let's just go in there.
And those are what we can see, right?
Doorways, and you have surmised by studying the dollhouse that there should be something behind that wall. But you don't see a way of actually getting to it.
Maybe all this crying wall.
Oh, let's go to the top door. So I'll use the hand for the handle or part of it.
The top door? The
yep.
Door? The door opens. Reveal area.
Can you zoom us out just a little bit?
Like that? To the side, you said?
Yeah.
Okay. So.
Do you not want any more
paper? Okay, go in the room and start investigating.
This dusty chamber is packed with old furniture, chairs, coat racks, standing mirrors, dress mannequins, and the like, all draped in dusty white sheets. Near an iron... There's a trunk, there's an iron stove, and a trunk next to it.
Mage hand that trunk,
Jason. All right, I will try to mage hand the trunk, lay it open.
And the trunk is unlocked. As you open it, you see inside like a bundle of white sheets speckled with red.
If I step that closer, does it appear to be blood or... Die or?
It looks like dried blood. If you want to know, actually, you'll have to be.
I'm not investigating that. I know what it is.
Okay.
anything else in the trunk?
Well, I mean, you've been looking at it from a distance. Are you actually going to go in there and start pulling things apart?
You guys have got some white sheets here that appear to have blood on them. You guys want to check this out?
You want to turn that on?
Yeah.
Put it down there.
I was looking at it. Jason, I'm busy being terrified of my own shadow.
Jason investigates the bundle.
Also,
it happens.
I like this rule.
Oh, I think that is a twisting of that rule. But I'll allow it.
I will investigate the bundle. I have no problem with
okay,
that.
Okay, so as you unwrap it, you find the skeletal remains of an adult.
Oh. I thought it was the little brother.
Yeah.
It appears to be wearing the tattered remains of some kind of maid's outfit. I'm pretty sure you went in a room before that had outfits, like maid outfits and stuff. In a closet on the second floor.
Huh. And was there anything underneath the tattered ruins of the skeleton?
No. It's just the skeleton and the nurse, or in the maid outfit, wrapped up in the sheets, stuffed in the trunk.
Can I beat on the wall south of the trunk? Does it sound hollow? Does it sound solid?
Make a perception check.
That's my new homie.
18. Oh, yeah, it does sound kind of hollow. But the wall also sounds pretty solid.
What else is in that room?
Old furniture. Chairs, coat racks, standing mirrors, dress mannequins, and stuff like that. Assorted furnishings that you would find in a house such as this.
What's the thing below the chair? Is that another furnace?
It looks like a stove.
Or a stove?
Yes.
Can I lift it off the ground?
Yeah, you lift it off the ground. It's
I have 16 strength. I'm gonna throw it into the wall.
Okay. Roll a strength check.
Why? 10.
10? Yeah, it just flies into the wall and kind of makes a big gash in the wood.
But can I see through this gash now?
No.
Okay, stone person coming through. I'm going to swing a blade at it.
Okay.
I can't stay. 13.
Yeah, you could still hit it. Is the goal here that you guys are just going to keep attacking that part of the wall until you get through?
No, we don't have to do that.
I mean, because I'm not going to, you know, I could calculate how much health the wall has and what it's damage resistant is, but if you guys keep at it long enough, yes, you will break through a wooden wall.
Well, it's not the same now, because my grandiose plan of throwing a stove through the wall failed, so now I don't even care how we get through.
Nothing.
Are you going to keep doing that, Austin, or are you going to just whack it once to see what happens?
While he does that, I'm investigating the remainder of the room, tossing the bed, you know, looking at every nook and cranny for anything.
While they're doing that, I'm just going to go back up the hallway and check the other door to the south there.
I was going to say.
And I rolled an 18 for investigating the rest of the room. Unless you'd like me to roll individually.
Okay. So, let's just go ahead and reveal this.
Whoa. See, I should have come into this room.
Oh, this might be the...
Yeah, so as you come into this room, it looks like a spare bedroom. It's got the same kind of thing going on where various furnishings are being kept. It has a stove, there's no trunk. And yeah, I believe if you just investigate this room, you find that there is a door over here. It's like revealed to you.
What are those in the room?
That looks like the cover.
The covered stuff. Because your DM read the wrong description, but same thing.
Oh.
Yeah, the 19 19 is where you find the body. 18 has the spare junk in it.
So while the crazy dwarf is beating on the wall to get through, I'm going to come around the other side and just casually open the door and greet him.
Well, you still can't greet him because the door's here. It's not on the other side. You just hear him whacking on the...
No, but when he comes through the wall...
Oh, you're going to wait however long it takes him to break down the wall big enough that he can climb through it?
Yes.
Are you going to bash on the wall that long, Austin?
Yeah, I will.
Okay.
I'll be terrified because I'll get to the wall and there'll be someone waiting for me.
All right, yeah, you keep smashing at the wall and it takes you quite a while.
My dog.
Eventually, the boards splinter and shatter and you force your way through. And,
well done.
You know, as you say, here's Golder, and break through the wall, you see, Minder on the other side.
Slowly clapping. Just slowly clapping.
I always pretend I didn't notice and just go downstairs.
So what was in the rooms that's spare junk and stuff covered by tarps?
Yeah, basically they're both spare rooms.
They didn't have tarps back then.
Well, sorry. Linens. Things covered by linens. I'd like to pull some of the linens off and just looking for things. Would I find anything interesting, anything?
No, just old, dusty furnishings.
Okay.
They might have once been, you know, really fancy, but time has not been kind to them in this house.
Okay. So I'm going to turn to Austin's character, and I'm going to address Thornbolt, who's possessing his body.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to tell him, we're going into the basement. Are you ready for this? What will we find down there?
All right. So he doesn't know that. He's never been to the basement. And Galder, you feel just like this overwhelming desire to crawl back into bed in the bedroom and whimper and cry yourself to sleep. But you're still in control of your body. So if you want to, you know, since he's saying this out loud, if you want to reply too, you're more than welcome to. But the ghost that's possessing you is not giving you any insights as to what might be in the basement.
Forgot we found three scrolls. Spell scrolls. You have those written down still? Okay.
Yeah, you found spell scrolls, you found books on demonic rituals that you determined were all fake, and you found several deeds that you left behind, and a letter from somebody named Strahd von Zarovich, basically telling the owners of this house that they were mad fools and they are damned, and he has no intention of helping them.
Actually, I think I grabbed all that extra paperwork because you left it behind, so it wasn't in the mind marketing book. I was the one to look through the rest of those.
So you took the deeds?
I did. I held on to them.
Okay. Because I remember Lawrence saying that he was leaving them behind.
Yeah. He left everything in the room except for the books that he used to study. And I went to study.
Okay. Fair enough. Alright, so who's going first? This is a spiral staircase, and probably only one of you could, you know, be on the same vertical piece at the same time. So who's going first? What's your marching order?
I'm going third.
Mm.
If we rest again, can we get
those new spells from our level 2. We did a long rest.
But he didn't get a long rest.
Oh, that's right.
Don't Warlocks get a short rest?
I do, but I wasn't sure if Andy said that we got all that stuff.
Oh, just go ahead, Lawrence.
I can have the spells?
Yeah, you can have the spell. The way you're rolling, man, I don't really need to like give you guys any disadvantage, or at least you any disadvantage. What's your marching order, Lawrence? You going last or second or first?
Tentatively second until I can figure out how long the spell lasts.
I'll bring up the rear. Or I'll look at the other door. Are you willing to go first?
I'll let you go first.
Okay. I'll go first.
I like that, Austin. That's a good role play. You are shagging and scooping it up in the back.
Oh my god, 10 minutes?
Yeah, never mind.
Protection from here.
Alright, so as you begin to start to descend this spiral staircase, it starts off wooden. And you feel like you are, in fact, descending through all the floors of the house. It's completely dark in here, and it's choked with cobwebs that you kind of have to push out of the way as you make your way down.
I
have a pretty good reason to. But,
also, I have holy water and powder, silver and iron.
Oh, we kind of hand need those. I don't think we've ever really kept track of the components. We just always kind of assume that we spend it because then we've really got to, I don't know, micromanage. That kind of stuff.
It was my assumption with spell components, at least from 3.5 on, that basically you either had your component pouch with you or you didn't. And you don't have to worry about individual, you know, you don't have to count back guano for casting fireballs.
Okay.
And that's the way I've always played it. I know some people do go stricter than that, especially on older editions, but I don't think that level of simulation is definitely not present in 5e. So, as you reach what you think might have been the ground floor, the staircase turns into stone. And as you reach the final step, you enter a 4-foot wide hallway. And the walls, the ceiling, and the floor are all earthen, and every 5 feet or so there are wooden support braces holding up the earth above it, basically keeping the tunnel stable. In front of you, you see a T intersection. And who was second? Minder was second. The rest of you are all still stuck on the staircase. Until some room's made.
Or is it not empty?
Yes.
No.
Okay.
Is one 10-foot object of 1 10-foot cube fit, right? 20 feet radius and within 20 feet. But I can't
have
multiple instances.
Can you roll a check to break being possessed?
What would you do with an obstinate child that wasn't doing what you wanted?
Well, I would take its tablet and put it in timeout. But seeing as this is a different time period, I might take the dwarf over my knee and spank him.
Wow, what are they doing?
That sure sounds like an intimidation check to me.
Yeah. I'm not sure how shooken up and how reliable
I'm out of bullshit.
Galder is gonna be in the coming fight while he's still possessed by a child.
If you imply to me that that's what you're trying to do, I can at least help you out.
Well, I think...
No, that burns up a spell slot. I'm not going to do that.
Yeah, that's what I'm going to try to do. Intimidate the spirit out of him.
Okay.
And see if maybe he can also assist me. Yes.
Wow.
The purple dragon.
Oh. Wow. Yeah.
What'd 21. 21? Yeah, yeah. You know, with some very stern words, the ghost, the spirit of Thorn, flees the body and returns back up the stairs from where he came from. You can kind of hear him sobbing in the distance as he leaves until the sound fades. I'll say you did that before you entered the stairwell. That's fine. Oh. When you get to the bottom, Jorn and Minder, you both start to hear this unearthly chanting, and you can't make out a direction or even the words, but it's this low, ominous chant that just keeps droning on.
I'm intrigued.
All
right. Are we going in?
What do you guys want to do?
I'm reasserting myself and pushing myself to the forefront.
Okay. Galder, emboldened after the spirit left his body, shoves his way past everyone.
That's the truth to us. He's not a creepy.
Give us the spirit, I swear.
Make sure. Oh. You see the earthen tunnels go to the north and south into the darkness. Oh, why can't you see that anymore? Oh, probably because I need to do this. There. You see the earthen tunnel to the north and south, go on into the darkness. You can see the wall appear, and it continues off. You don't see any stop down there. How far can dwarves see in the dark? Do they have dark vision?
Yeah, 60 feet.
60 feet, 5, 10, 15, 20, 25. God.
I have devil sight.
You can see all the way. I believe that's a wall right there. Yes. You can see down, there's like a wooden table, and you can't see much else in the room, but you can see that it ends in another hallway that turns off at a 90 degree angle.
Can you zoom out just a little bit?
That's too far.
That's good. Perfect.
What do you guys want to do?
I like the camera more.
You're a little girl.
You're watching your dice.
Let's split up.
Yeah. That never got anyone killed.
Let's check out the table. Stop talking to each other and check out the table.
Always works so
good. I'll peek around the corner to the north there, to the right, just before we go south. I'll step up into that square and stand there while everyone goes past me, and then I'll bring up the rear as we go south.
Okay, so you want to step up to this square and peek around the corner?
Yeah.
To the right?
Yeah. Okay. That way everyone can get around me, and I'm just kind of guarding the back.
You see a tunnel that goes off in that direction, and it also splits off into a T. Minder can step forward, and Asandra, that was bringing up the rear, can now finally enter the tunnels. And you too, Asandra, notice that these are earthen and stone tunnels. Every 5 or so feet, there's wooden beams built into the walls and up overhead. And you also hear the strange, ominous chanting in the darkness.
On the screen, it's disappointing. Dwarves, you get stone cutting for a history check. Instead, all it says that it doubles your proficiency in it. Our proficiency is -1.
Everybody knows the double -1 is -2.
So you know even less.
Can we tell which direction the chanting's coming from?
No, not at all. It's omnipresent.
To the tables.
So you want to head down.
I'll be right behind
Galder. When we get to the intersection, if no one else does, I'm going to look 360 before going through it.
I didn't even notice that. Alright,
so who's going first into that room?
Galder.
And everybody else? What's the marching order?
I'll be number 3.
I'm last.
Right,
middle school math problem. Which position is Lawrence?
2 + 2 = 5. Common core.
Yep, so you see more hallways that branch off as you march down. And then as Galder enters this room, you see a small room carved out of the earth. In it's a long wooden table, and there are moldy bones all over the ground.
Okay, I'm jumping onto the table and defensive stance.
What's everybody else doing?
I'm gonna look at Galder kind of oddly.
I thought you weren't possessed anymore.
What the fuck you doing, bro?
Before I go through that intersection, I'll step to the shorter side, so the left 23, and just look around, and then step back.
I'm gonna hang out where I am, but I'm gonna prep a fireball. Not fireball, but a fire bolt. If I see something, you know, dangerous happen, I'm going to shoot it.
All right, so you step... You step into that small alcove, and you notice that there's, like, two stone doors to the north and south.
No, if they're not moving forward through the hall, I'll step over to the other 23 on the right and do the same thing, just do a quick spin, quick peek both directions, and then back.
Same deal. Stone slabs.
And then I'll step back and report to them if they haven't moved on.
Okay, so he comes back and tells the rest of you that in each of those alcoves, there are two stone slabs. since he's just doing a quick glance in each one.
Possible doors, possible door.
I'm gonna walk over to 27.
You're in 27. That's
true. To the dot.
To the actual dot. Okay.
And look down the hall.
It immediately turns the corner and goes 90 degrees to the north.
I look at the dwarf. Which way?
I'll head that direction, and every turn I'm ending in a defensive stance.
So you're going first?
Yes.
What's everybody else doing?
I'll bring up the rear.
Asandra, anything special?
No. No, just kind of following the group at this point.
Okay.
Wait for something to pop out of the woodwork. Bone bones, animate or something.
Okay. So you round the corner. I'm not going to keep moving you guys till you decide where you want to go. You round the corner, and you see a set of stairs, like carved into the earth, going down. And then, I believe another set going down as well. And then you can tell in the distance there's a larger room over here, but you can't quite see into it very far.
Do you want to investigate any of the side rooms first?
I would feel better settling this level to...
Yeah, because that's a boss fight room up to it, so... Yeah, let's go to those things. Slab, whatever. 23?
There's a bunch of 23s. There's this one, and this one.
I think we should go all the way back
up. Take us to the one that's got loot.
I think it's all the way back up to the original hallway and took the one to the left and just start up there.
That's not an option.
You mean all the way up here and go left and explore this direction?
Yep. That's what Tom said.
Okay. I'm going to keep you guys in this marching order.
That's fine.
Just because I'm tired of asking.
It's a good marching order.
Unless we decide otherwise, let you know, I think that is perfectly acceptable.
Yep, when you get to the intersection of this room, there's also a set of stairs down, and you can see like a wooden table.
Let's enter the room.
Okay, you guys enter the room.
I stop and I go down to the right hand 23 at the top right first. When we go past.
Okay.
It's going.
And you're gonna go in there, alright. In this case, when you enter there, the stone slabs are pulled to the side.
I back away slowly and quick as possible and get the grip stitch.
Alright, so you notice that the one labeled A, the stone slab, is completely blank. And there's an engraving on the slab as you slowly back away. It says Walter Durst. And you don't see anything inside.
Durst
family. Portia was the Durst family, and I think that's probably the dad.
There's a black one next to him?
Yeah, probably the one. Can I head over there and investigate? I go back to the group and say, just in case anything's going on, let's keep it a little quiet when we go over here. And just go slow.
So you want to go over and investigate those?
Yeah, I want to investigate Fred Durst. Walter.
Yeah.
See if it looks like there was... If it's been used or not. Or if there's anything in there.
Yeah, you can just walk in and look. It's totally empty. Roll an investigation roll. It doesn't even look like this stone slab has ever actually been pushed into place.
Okay. So maybe he was just prepping his tombstone down here for when he did die. It's pretty gross to bury your family in the basement, though.
What about the other side? Let's go investigate that side.
Yeah.
That one is also completely empty. And there's nothing carved on the stone slab.
And we can't really see anything to the right of the map there. Is that...
No, sorry. It doesn't go any farther.
Okay.
There's a little bit, you know... Goes in a little bit, but that's it. They're both just carved out, but empty.
So why the group goes down into the... to check out the room with the tables. Can I quickly kind of like jog down to 23, the bottom two?
Okay.
Just take a look at the doors to see if there was any writing on them.
I go with you.
Yeah.
And the priest is gone with me. Just to read the inscriptions. I mean, you don't have to move me unless...
Yeah, that's fine. Let me just reveal... the letters. So, C?
You can't see that C.
C is... Can you see my mouse right here? No. Oh, yeah, you can't see it. It's too far over. How can I do this so you can see it?
Move the map while you're zooming in. It doesn't
want
to.
Okay, we can
kind of
see it now.
Yeah, you can kind of see it. C. That's the stone on the stone slab on the outside says Gustav Durst. The one below it says Elizabeth Durst. On the other side, the top one, E, says Rosavalda Durst.
Rosavalda
Durst, and the one below it, F, has Thornbolt Durst.
Let's go get the kids.
You're right.
Let's go
to C&D.
Yep.
I think it was C&D.
No, it's E and F. E and F are the ones labeled Rose and Thorn.
Yep. Oh, well, that's right. The kids were Rose and Thorn.
Yeah, do we have time to do that?
You don't have any... There's no time limit that you're aware that you're under.
Okay.
Just
so...
Kind of like come upstairs, grab those kids, and bring them down.
Okay. So, you have their remains. It didn't take any effort to climb back up the stairs. You went into the attic and picked up their remains. This time the ghosts didn't appear. You take them down, and what do you guys do? You're outside ENF.
Is there any type of opening mechanism or just sliding in the door? Or?
No, it looks like it's you're going to have to manhandle them, maybe use your weapons as leverage to kind of, you know, like a crowbar to pull the slab open. So to do that, you'll need to roll some strength checks.
Why was the stone slab inserted in the wall if the corpses weren't in there already?
18.
18? Okay, that's one. Roll another one.
15 plus 3.
Okay, you both are able simultaneously to open the slabs, and each one there is an empty coffin on a stone dais, you know, like raised up a little bit on a piece of stone. There's an empty coffin.
Okay.
Let's put the remains into their respective coffins and put the slabs back.
All right. So as you
and then I'll say a prayer over them.
So as you lower Rose's corpse into the or skeletal remains into her coffin, the person that's doing that just feels like there's just been this little bit of weight lifted off their back that they've felt kind of ever since they entered this house, and ever so slightly you hear like just a whisper that says thank you. The person holding Thorn's skeleton just hears this, you know, sniffling and crying as you walk it over to the coffin, and when you lower it in, it just stops. And you also feel like a little bit of weight has been lifted off of your back. What do you guys do?
I cry a little bit.
I'll say a prayer.
Okay.
Put the doors back on and head up to 24.
Just give me one second.
Stupid all. Yeah.
This is the name, not the set.
I know. this is going to be so good.
You guys get something. There we go.
Plus one quarterstaff.
Minus 5 points.
That's fine. I should,
All right, so all of you, for laying Rose and Thorn to rest, you gain inspiration. For one roll of your choice, you may select to have advantage on that roll.
That's what inspiration does.
And it can be an ability check, an attack roll, or a saving throw.
Huh. Can you choose to use inspiration after you've rolled?
Through here, it doesn't. I'm gonna say you need to say that you're gonna use it before
okay. You
roll.
That's sad. Okay. All right.
So you can continue to this room with the
24.
Okay. Dude. A little bit closer.
Beds.
Yeah. But why would you sleep in a burial chamber?
Alright, so it says a wooden table and 4 chairs stand at the east end of this room. As you look around, there's like 4 alcoves, and in the alcoves are like moldy straw pallets.
Well,
investigate them? Never mind.
Yeah, you tear the straw apart, and they just appear to be what I described. They're just old. The straw has been there for ages, and it's starting to crumble and fall apart to dust. And you don't find anything.
Okay. So not to backtrack, but can we go back to the other wooden table, down to room 27, and then continue south and east?
So, okay, you want to keep going.
Yeah, we want to go back.
You guys are all over the frickin' place.
We're just trying to get you to slip up with moving the map, clearly.
Left looks ominous. I don't want to die.
I played enough Zelda, I know what happens when you go down to the back upstairs.
Yeah.
Alright, so what direction do you want to go? Down to these stairs? Or down here? Looping to the left, or over here?
Down.
Real quick,
I'm going to look over at Asandra and ask her to summon her mage hand again.
Okay. Not doing that for you with my mage hand. Stop asking.
Don't make me get my ward. I'm going to use my bullshit
order. Alright, so are you going to do that, Asandra?
Yeah.
What do you want?
Just summon it. I just want to see what it looks like.
Okay. So, all right. Summon my mage hand. Is that still a skeleton hand?
Yep.
Okay.
Now, Jason, when you were asking about your familiar, you hadn't cast the ritual yet to summon one?
Not in this game. I'd imagine I have at some point prior to this, though. But you said it's per plane or whatever, so...
So, I'm going to say, since you didn't mention having it before, you didn't have one when you showed up.
Okay.
Alright, you guys are going to be the death of me. You step in here, and it continues on turning.
Andy, just can you move the map just a little bit to the right so we can see the right side?
Let me do this.
Maybe something over there. Let's see how.
Trying to determine if I step away from the group again and this guy's looking or not.
Because of the shape, it doesn't really fit as well, but you can see more of the map like that. Does that work?
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
Okay, so just the end of the room there where the number 28 is, it's just kind of an little alcove that only can see from the room.
Yes, it is an alcove.
I'll just go step into the alcove real quick.
Okay.
And then check it out. So what's the message? 14 on investigation in that room.
Right, so as you approach and you're investigating it, it looks like this alcove might have been used as a larder at one point. As you come to that, what's your passive perception?
What is passive perception?
What is it, guys? 10 plus your wisdom modifier?
There you go.
Or is it 8 plus your wisdom modifier plus your proficiency bonus? I can't remember.
I don't think you add proficiency. I think it's 10.
10 plus your wisdom modifier, dude.
Correct us in the YouTube comments.
That'd be 13.
13? So with 13, as a passive perception, you notice that this slimy creature falls out of a hole in the larder and begins to attack you.
I look over my shoulder and say, "Hey, you guys!"
He's good in the voice.
That's okay. All I got for now.
Hmm.
A slimy creature? Alright.
Yes.
What would...
I will show you a picture of this creature.
I think we faced one before, but I'm trying to remember what it was called. Okay. No,
it looks like that.
If I'd like to roll to know if I know what the creature is, what would you like me to roll, Andy?
Knowledge nature.
Knowledge intelligence nature. Oh. I rolled a 21.
It's a Grick.
Holy shit, that's a Grick!
They are passive predators. They like to ambush people that come by, and they live underground. Everyone roll initiative, please.
Yeah, where did the brick come from, Andy?
What's up?
What plane of existence?
Lots of them. General pests. And roving ambusher of the unwary.
8 feet long, weighs about 200 pounds. Feet too.
I rolled a 12.
A 12. That is going to be. Is that your total or what you rolled?
That's my total.
Okay. Austin, what'd you get?
Seven.
Man, that was your last one. Tom, what did you get?
Four.
And Jason, what did you get?
18.
Okay. So something that vaguely resembles generic monster token. Just so I don't have to worry about it. Plop. Yes, it attacks you. It goes first. ...18 to hit.
I have an AC of 18.
Isn't it meter exceeds, guys?
Yeah, it is.
Okay, so you are going to take 6 points of slashing damage, if that makes a difference, as it attacks you with the tentacles that surround its beak. Because it hits you with those tentacles, it like kind of latches on and lurches forward and snaps at you with its beak. And is unable to penetrate the protective armor that you are wearing. And then up is going to be Jason. It's your turn.
All right. I'm going to go ahead. Now it's
like no, it hasn't grappled you. But basically it used the hitting you with its tentacles as an opportunity to kind of lurch forward and snap at you with its beak. But it's not like wrapped around you like an octopus would be.
I'm going to go ahead and I'll just cast Firebolt on it.
Okay.
One is always a miss.
Yeah, I rolled a one.
You rolled a one? Yeah, that's not going to hit. Are you going to move or do anything else?
No, I'm good. Actually, move me up one.
Move you up one. Azamba. Minder, it is your turn.
Alright. I am going to stand behind Jorn. And then I'm going to tell Jorn to move out of the way and lure it into the center of the room.
So you're going to stand behind him?
Yeah, kind of on the table. Okay. Just in the square behind him.
Yeah.
And then I'm gonna verbally tell him, you know, it's like, you know, bring it into the center of the room, you know, because it's kind of in an alcove.
Okay.
And then I'm going to cast Eldritch Blast on it.
All right, go for it.
That's cool, because I didn't want to hit it. 15?
Yeah, that hits.
Four damage.
Alright. Does that Eldritch Splash do anything other than damage?
No.
Okay. So you have moved and attacked. Guldur, it's your turn. You hear a commotion as Jorn is attacked by some creature that you can't see.
I'm charging down just below him, and I'm going to take a swing at it.
Okay.
19?
Yeah, that hits.
6 damage. Slashing.
Alright, so as you hit it with your weapon, you're sure that you struck true. But the damage on its scaly hide doesn't appear to be as much as you would expect. Jorn, it's your turn.
So if I move away, it'll press attack and let's say disengage, right?
If you full disengage, you can move as far away as you want. But I believe if you move one to the angle, you're not leaving its threat range, so it doesn't provoke an attack of opportunity.
Correct. Alright, so I'll step north one square, and then...
There we go. Boom. North one square.
And then I will go ahead and try taking a swing with my Warhammer.
Okay.
Where
is my weapon?
Sorry. Oh,
that's
fine. Okay. I know I had something done.
Just, melee attack?
Yeah. Or, strength. Yeah. Strength. Yeah,
strength. Strength and your proficiency. For an attack.
Okay. So, 14, 16.
16, that hits.
Two damage.
Plus your strength.
Oh, 4 damage.
4 damage? Right. Okay. Alright, yeah, you smack it with your hammer, but its thick scaly hide absorbs the blow partially. Moved and attacked. Any other actions that you have up your sleeve? I'll take that as a no.
Yeah, that's all.
Okay. Alright. It rolled a 19 to hit.
Boom. Who's it attacking?
It's going to continue to attack its original prey that came near the larder. So. It hits you with its tentacles again and does 5 points of damage. And again, it lurches at you to take a bite out of you with its grotesque beak. And that is a 22 to hit.
Ouch.
And 5 damage on that.
I'm hurting, guys.
Spend your life strangling yourself.
Alright, Asandra, it is your turn.
Oh my god.
What do I know about the creature that it's afraid of or dislikes or anything like that? That it's natural prey or natural predator, any sort of thing. Besides that, having a scaly hide, what else do I know about?
You know that they basically that they like to hide in holes. They natural habitat is pretty much everywhere underground, including. They're tough enough that they can live in the Underdark, and they consume virtually anything that moves except for other Griggs. Yeah, you know that they have a very thick hide, and mundane weapons won't be effective against it.
Alright, I guess we'll go ahead and cast Firebolt again for now. But you know what? I take that back. I'm going to use my magic missile.
Okay.
One action and one bonus action.
Oh, okay. So, 4 and 4. I can get an action and a bonus. 4, 4, and 3. That's
well, to dis-
11.
Bonus action.
11 damage?
Yes.
Yeah, you noticed that those magic missiles, as you shot 3? That's why you had 3 damage rolls?
Yeah.
Yeah, so you notice all 3 of them strike true, and they seem to be inflicting the damage that you would expect. That was 11, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, it's bleeding from all 3 of those wounds quite heavily.
Takes a move action and a standard action.
Are you gonna move it all?
And then use a bonus action.
No.
All right, Minder, it is your turn.
I will go ahead and Eldritch Blast it again.
Okay.
Nat 20.
He actually did roll a nat 20. Used up all of his dice rolls for the year.
Yeah.
Okay. So roll your damage dice twice and add your modifier once. I believe that is how crits work.
Modifiers to my spell.
Okay. So just roll your damage dice twice.
Wow.
Oh my god. I didn't change anything by saying that. You know that was the ultimate.
You didn't have to say it ahead of time.
One and a two.
So just.
3 damage. Jason cursed me.
3 damage on a crit.
I just called it how it is.
Okay.
I did nothing.
He's so coming on the table.
It still looks pretty hurt, but it's not dead. Are you going to move it all?
Nope. I'm good.
All right.
I'm going to yell obscenities at it.
Golder, what do you do?
Okay, swinging at it, aiming for the wands.
Eleven to hit.
Yeah.
You miss, smacking the earthen wall next to it.
Okay, action surge.
Okay.
18.
That hits.
Awesome. 11 damage.
Yeah, as you aim for those wounds, you're able to jam your weapon into one, and using the leverage, you basically, like, can open the hide of this beast, spilling its guts on the earthen floor. So it is quite dead.
Yeah. That's frustrating.
We
got one.
Yeah.
All right, guys. What do you want to do?
Fortify the area and let Jorn rest.
So you're going to take a short rest?
Well, do you want to cast some spells on yourself and heal, or do you want to take a short rest and expend some dice?
So I didn't use a spell. Yes. I would prefer to hold on to my hand.
Okay.
What's the short rest do for healing?
As a short rest, you can use your hit dice. We have 2 hit dice right now because we're level 2. And you can use your hit dice and roll it, and gain hit points back.
A long rest to give your hit dice back.
It gives you half your hit dice back per long rest.
So we've done a short rest and a long rest, so we only would have 1 dice then?
We would have one back.
You'd have one back. So if you used one on the last short rest, and then you did a long rest, you would get half your total back, and you were level 2 when you took the long rest.
Oh, I need some longer. So you have
one right now, and you could expend one.
Couldn't we have 2 if we took a long rest?
If you hadn't used one yet.
Fine. And then we took a long rest.
He was at 0.
Oh.
And then took a long rest and got half of his back, which would be 1.
Yeah, you used 1.
Well, we're at level 1. I used 1 short rest.
That's true, okay. Yeah. Because we were only level 1, we only had 1, right?
Yeah, and I'm pretty sure the minimum's 1, so if you take a long rest at level 1, you just gain that 1 back.
Right.
So either way, whether he's level 1 or level 2, he only gained 1 back.
Right. And we don't gain the hit die when we level to start with?
What?
He's at 0, he gained a level, he got 1.
What? I thought we had 1 hit dice at level 1.
We did. And I used it.
And he's at 0, and then he's like, he levels up and he gets another hit dice, so he should have 1.
That makes sense.
That's what I'm questioning,
And then he's going to regain 1?
I don't know.
You have rules lawyered me into agreeing, that's fine.
But we're not taking a long rest, so it's not going to get
one. Well, we did earlier.
Oh.
We did.
You're right. Right.
And I made the successful save to actually have a long rest.
So you would have 2 hit dice then?
Right.
Yeah, that's fine.
I agree with that.
Okay.
Too much math.
I know, that's what I'm trying to like. At what point do we have math? At what point do we have a game?
So, yeah, roll 2 hit dice. And your hit die is whatever your class is. Like, I'm a 1d8.
I'm a 1d8.
So, roll 2d8 and gain them.
But I can use 1 if I wanted to.
Yeah, you could use 1, and then if it wasn't enough, you could use another 1.
Let's just use 1 for now. Let's see what that does. That's 5, yeah. Use 2. It's probably 9. And, should I use a spell?
Do you have a heal cantrip?
There aren't no heal cantrips.
Can we head south?
Yeah. So, let me just describe this for you.
Describe the dead Gant.
What's up? The dead what? Grit?
Grit?
Grit? Grit. G-R-I-C-K. So it's dead and putrefying on the floor. It looks like its lair was just a shallow hole in the wall that it was sort of waiting for things to come by that it could attack and eat. But you don't find anything of value in there.
Oh. What about Ingrid's stomach?
No, you don't find that, anything that. But digesting and rotten meat. Alright, so as you head to the south, you see the tunnel continue on into the darkness. And you see it goes up into a T intersection.
So many intersections!
I'll say you're right about here, you can see that. I'm just not going to reveal it.
Alright, left to right, guys.
Right.
All right. Okay. So as you march down to where the T intersection is, once Galder reaches it, once Galder steps,
kill myself.
Okay, so we'll do that. There you go. You hear the earth churning from multiple directions. Galder, right in front of you. You see down this hallway two ghouls where it is marked X next to you begin to emerge from the ground, and you can see an additional one at this intersection or this turn in the hallway pulling itself from the soft earth.
Since they just came out of the dirt, do I get to attack first, or what?
I don't know, they keep its fucking head off.
Just push it back into the
dirt.
No, it's able to kind of spring up out of the ground fast enough that, yeah, you're not surprised, but,
down.
It's also not surprised. It's expecting you. And you can see one kind of coming around the corner from this direction. Everybody, roll initiative, please.
That's cool. See you back.
Seventeen for Minder.
Minder is 17. Asandra?
17.
17 as well?
Yep.
Okay. Which one of you wants to go first?
Who? Between you and me?
Between the two 17s. Have a roll off. Whoever rolls higher gets to go first.
Sure. I go first.
Zamba, you go first. Galder.
15.
15? Jorn, what'd you get?
6. I don't like going first.
At least these are all G monsters.
Let's see how hard these guys are. I'm going to be low on the spell on you guys right now.
Almost there, giant. Hill giant. Oh my god, all the giants. There we go.
You can't cast the spell and attack, right?
No, they're both actions. Unless you have some ability that lets you do that.
Okay. All right. Okay. So.
The first ghoul rounds the corner, but is blocked from attacking by by the one that's closer to you. So it snarls and snaps at you in the hallway. That is Jorn. No, that's Minder. Minder, you're up.
Okay, can I attack the one diagonal to me? Doorway.
It's kind of around the corner. Yeah, I'll let you guys attack the Grick around the corner. I don't know if that's truly legal, but I'll let you do it.
I can't move through.
Yeah, you're kind of stuck.
Can't move past each other?
I think you can move past each other through an ally, but you can't move into an ally square and then attack. Because you're both occupying the same square.
But if after he attacks and wants to move back...
He could, yeah.
So I can't cast the spell and then attack, huh?
No, you can't.
You can?
No, you cannot attack and cast a spell unless the spell is like a bonus action.
Alright, I'm going to cast Armor of Agathys on myself.
Okay.
I gain 5 temporary hit points.
Okay.
And I'm going to move diagonal to the left of Galder. And then spit on that ghoul to get its attention. As a bonus action.
Okay. I'll let you squeeze past him. You're going to take an attack of opportunity because you're actually stepping out of that ghoul's threatened range. Since we're letting you guys attack around corners.
Can I? Since I have a movement of 30, can I move back and forth twice to provoke attack of opportunities from both of them?
No, because only one can reach you.
Okay. Alright, that's fine.
Okay.
Let him attack me.
Alright, he sees you moving away and instinctively claws at you to keep you in place. That is going to be 14 to hit.
That hits.
Alright, so you're going to take 4 slashing damage from the claws, the decaying claws of this ghoul. Make a constitution saving throw.
Seven?
You are paralyzed and unable to move.
Oh my god. Okay, he takes 5 cold damage.
Okay.
That's Don't I move, though?
No, because the attack goes off before you, you know, as you're moving. Basically, the it resolves before you make your move, because you're, like, moving out. And because
yes,
he's paralyzed you, you don't actually move.
Fall into the other square?
No.
Paralyzed?
No, you're paralyzed.
Slumped in the entryway? Paralysis. Like that.
Alright. So how much damage does it take?
5 cold.
5 cold. Okay. Setting up their health pools. Alright. Up next is Asandra.
So pushes paralyzed us. I don't know why I have moved this, but it's full circle.
Would I take a disease if my temporary hit points were the ones that were hit?
It's not a disease. It's an effect of the undead aura that surrounds ghouls and how they hunt. And no, your temporary hit points won't protect you from something like that.
That's stupid shit.
Tell me how you really feel, Larry.
So, I'm going to use Minor Illusion to cast a 5-foot by 5-foot block in the area. And can I make it appear as though it's fallen from the ceiling, like, let's say 5 feet of rubble, 5 feet tall? So I can cast 5-by-5 cube illusion. And it includes visible and audible, so I can have it cave in from a wall on the ceiling and crash down, or basically it would be on top of Lauren, but it's an illusion, but it would bury him, so they think that the way is cut off by rubble.
Is it, so what's the rule for them to decide whether they believe that or not? I'm not familiar with the spell.
Investigation check? Int versus spell DC.
Int versus spell DC.
I can't imagine ghouls have int, so that should be an automatic fail.
Alright, what's your spell DC?
13.
13? Okay.
So I'd like to do that and then tell one of the other two that's up in the order that to grab him out of the illusionary rubble.
You.
I can't do both.
Well, then it would be Galler. The Galler would have to either believe or not believe the same illusion.
Okay.
It's an illusion.
Almost can't find that. Sure.
You've cast your illusion. It looks like, oh. So it looks like, the ceiling has caved in on Minder. You're not sure how the ghouls have reacted to that quite yet. Galder, you are also rolling intelligence to see if you think that you have just been buried in with a bunch of ghouls trying to eat you.
Yeah, we are. He was there.
He got buried. Now you might think you're alone.
But following here? But I said to both of them, though. It's only in the 5-foot block that Lawrence is in.
Yeah, but it came down on top of him and it's covering him, right?
So now it looks like I'm alone and I'm rolling to see if you're losing the pool. But how would you be alone? I don't see...
The illusion, he dropped it right here.
I thought that he was in the crossroads.
No.
Okay.
So he attacked diagonally?
Yes. Well, he was okay. Trying to step... Because I let you guys attack the Grick diagonally.
I misunderstood. So where are we dropping? On top of Lauren. I guess on top of him. I misunderstood where we were.
Man. You said on top of Mender.
Okay, well...
Right there. So you're alone.
I didn't hear the part where we were attacking around the corner, so...
So he's deciding whether or not you think you're alone. So roll to see if you...
It's like 13.
No, I don't believe it.
Okay.
Those are petty and stupid.
All right.
But I also don't want to make it look like the illusion is fake.
Okay. Oh. Yeah. If you step into it, they'll know that something's up. I would say that. That is a wise thing. Alright, so that was a spell cast. So you're not going to be able to drag him away until next round.
Let's see if it's going to rise.
Are you going to move in or out, or are you going to wait?
I'll step out into the right.
Like that?
Yep.
Okay. Golder, it is your turn.
Okay. I'm going to disengage and move to the left.
How far? There's a hallway that runs.
Just one.
Just one? Disengage just one?
Yeah. Can I look down the stairs to see what's down there?
Yeah. It is another T hallway.
I'm going to end in the classic defensive stance.
Okay. I don't know if you can take defensive stance if you've used your disengage, which is basically like both actions, isn't it?
No, the defensive thing is just the, it's not dodge like the other thing. It's just a bonus action. Let's have it right here.
Okay, cool. If it's just a bonus action, you're fine then. Alright, so what is this one going to do? So this ghoul thinks that it can't get towards the paralyzed prey, so it's going to move one forward, turn,
paralyzed,
and continue to... Well, it's turned towards Golder and starts to attack him.
What? Thinks you're dead?
I know.
That is going to be like 23 to hit.
Oh, Jesus. Yeah, that hits.
Right, so it rakes its claws across you. Does 5 points of damage. Roll a constitution saving throw.
Now. 13?
You're fine. Just nasty claws run across your flesh. Cause that 5 points of damage.
An at-will spell counts as a standard a spell action, right?
Yep.
Jorn, it is your turn.
Alright, I'll step up into the gap.
Okay.
I'm going to use my channel divinity in this case for turn undead. As long as they can hear me up to 30 feet away, they should flee on a wisdom saving throw.
So it's based on sound, not on line of sight?
It's both, visual or sound.
Does it say or does it say and?
See or hear you within 30 feet.
Hear is fine. They can all hear you.
Yeah. And I have to do a wisdom saving throw.
Okay. What do they have to beat?
That is a good question. What do their characters beat? What do they have to beat?
So that would be your 8 plus your proficiency bonus plus what? Your charisma?
The what?
Your spell save DC is 8 plus your proficiency bonus, which is 2,
plus.
Where did you get this from?
I have it written down. The bonus there.
Yeah, but I'm trying to figure out where he's getting this from. So I'm like,
the rule book. I just wrote it down in tiny letters here, so I would know it. But it's the DC is based off of a base 8 plus 2 from your proficiency bonus plus whatever your spell modifier is. Are you charisma?
No, wisdom.
Then it would be plus whatever your wisdom is.
3.
So then it would be plus 3. So it would be 13.
13?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's the same as me then.
And me.
Oh, and you.
And me. Well, I'm not a man.
The one in the hallway fails. And we'll go to the right and then down. The next one fails. The third one fails. The fourth one fails. They all hear you. Now, what does it do?
They run away for a minute or until they take damage.
Run away for a minute until they take damage. Where the heck would they go?
That's why I was like, counting, like,
I got the opportunity attacks without using my reaction.
I'll go down.
Do you have reach?
Yeah,
4. So I get 2 of them.
Do you hear that, Andy?
What's up?
Okay. While in this defensive stance, I can make opportunity attacks without using my reaction.
Okay.
So, yeah, I can hit 2 of them because I have 10 foot of reach.
All right, that's fair. So let's do this.
You can make more than one opportunity attack around.
Not using a reaction. If it's a reaction, you can only use one.
Oh,
because of the stance he took when he finished his turn.
And if anything moves more than 5 feet within my reach, I can also hit it as my reaction.
Do you have full arm action?
No. You can't make 2 either way.
The what?
When you make an opportunity attack, you can't hit with all your attacks anymore.
Oh. So well, full arm mastery lets me attack something when it walks into my threat range as well.
Okay.
I've only got a quarter staff, so I don't have the 10-foot range yet, so it has to literally walk right into the square. But in a few levels, I will also be picking up the blade.
Alright, so... what I'm going to have them do is they think that the earth has crumbled in there, and they see you in this hallway, and they're terrified of whatever has cast that holy sound that they cannot stand. So they're going to run into these adjacent rooms for a minute. You may make your 2 attack of opportunities against these 2 guys.
The guy on the left.
The guy on the left. Roll.
19.
That hits.
17.
17 damage?
Or yes, 17 to hit.
17 to hit the other one? Yeah, that hits too. Okay, so roll damage on the first one.
Okay, 6 damage to the one on the left.
Okay.
And 12 damage to the one on the right.
So basically you ride down and hit one with the stick and with the end of it.
Chop this right down.
Clunk, clunk.
So, and Tom, you said that lasted until they 1 minute or until they took damage, right?
Yes.
Okay. So this one, and I'm just going to kind of set them to the side. Those 2, they scamper off down the hallways. These 2, since you hit them as they're trying to turn to flee, actually just stand where they're stay where they're at.
That second one. I can hold out by myself for a while, but it'll help you do that.
Yeah, I can hit you with the 1d4.
Alright, so you moved and cast a spell. Are you going to do anything else, Tom?
Not at this time.
Okay.
Hold on. That radiant damage could be this one.
So this one is going to clamber over here. And attempt to claw at you. A 20 to hit.
Jesus Christ, these rolls are amazing. Yeah, that hits.
He rolled a 16. That's gonna be 7 damage. Roll a constitution saving throw.
Sure. They're running.
No, he won't. He attacked him.
He's not listening to that thing. He's not that.
I did
miss all the important data.
I did.
Okay. Constitution save.
There you go.
That's not
going to
help.
19.
I'll just start with
you. You're fine. That one's fleeing. That one's fleeing. Minder, so you're still paralyzed. Your turn is, you're not going to get to take any actions on your turn. But at the end of your turn, you may roll the Constitution saving throw again to see if you're able to break yourself out of this paralysis.
No.
What'd you roll?
7.
Is that the total or what you got?
8.
8 total? Okay. Yeah, you're still paralyzed. Asandra, it is your turn.
Awesome.
Did I get 2 of those?
Their attacks
are
so amazing.
Yeah. I'll give you 2.
I can hit the one in the middle of the area, right?
No, that's a little bit too much.
If I move one to the left, I should be able to, because that's only around the one corner. I say, if they can hit him around the other corner, then they should be able to hit.
That's trying to do a Z, dude. I'm not going to let you do that.
I don't know. I think that it's no more of an angle from the X to where Lauren is paralyzed. But you're the DM. You can make the decision.
All the other cells are one action. Well, she'll pick this one both action as well. Hey, Andy.
Hey, what?
Cast times. It says the cast time is one bonus action.
Okay, yeah, that's a bonus action. Is there something else you wanted to do? You moved and did a bonus action.
Oh, I was having a conversation with Austin, just confirming when I could do it or if I could do it.
A bonus action's on your turn, and so normally you get a standard action, a move action, and then a bonus action if you have a class ability that allows you to do something like that.
So he could cast a spell and then cast that as a bonus action.
Yeah, I don't think I'd have to look that up to be 100% sure, but I don't think that Turn Undead is actually a spell. It's like an ability.
Yeah, it is.
So you would be able to cast a spell and an ability.
Okay.
I'm not sure about that.
Yeah, no, I use Channel Within the Eternal as the primary Channel Within me. I also have another Channel Within set of Lord Within me. The Life Preserve Channel Within me I have is also a reference to healing.
So, if we pass through an area and step out of it, but the area is obscured, say by fog, they still would not get an opportunity to attack them because they can't see, correct?
Are you saying if you step out of the illusion and cross diagonal, that they won't get an opportunity to attack if you push your way past everybody?
I'm saying if there was fog in the area and it obscured vision, then it's
producing more heat than it is.
If Lawrence were, or if Austin were to step by the ghoul and pass, he would not get an opportunity to attack, right?
Yeah, if he had some ability that let him pass through an enemy. But normally you can't.
Why don't we want to go back in there to begin with?
Because we can't fight in there. I can't hit them from where I am.
I'm pulling them back.
I still can't hit them from where I am.
Yeah,
always not
we're
acting paralyzed ass out of the way and move yourself into a better position.
I can't do both.
This
is bad.
I'm going to grab him on the next turn. And I'm going to haul his ass
out. Oh, I guess I'm just going to stand there and twiddle my thumbs.
Can you hold your action?
I can drop it, but
and we'll hold it until after
I drops it forever. I guess, yeah, I'll drop my action to the end of the turn order.
Actually, you know what? I'm going to take this opportunity to find my familiar. How's that?
Going to cast this spell?
Sure.
Is that a ritual or is that just a spell?
It is. I'm just going to hang out and do my ritual.
Rituals take like 10 minutes to do.
Yep. I know. I have nothing else to do. Why not?
He's literally trying to kill us right now.
Well, you guys wanted to fight in the hallway.
I'm trying not to metagame here, but there's an obvious thing that you could do right now to get yourself in.
I would be metagaming if I did that.
Jason already called and he's been concentrating on a ritual for 10 minutes.
Yep. No need for bullshit. Okay.
Jason is out of the fight. That's cool. I'm just drooling on this little kind of this illusionary pile of a bowl.
Yep. Whose turn is it now?
It was his, and now it is yours.
Okay. I think gamble on second one. Yeah, okay, I'm doing my second one.
Okay.
I get 10 health, but...
Is your familiar cure paralysis?
Nope.
No.
No, but
I don't know what my alchemist is.
I have alchemist stuff so I can, grind its bones on down into a paralysis cure potion.
If you had moved out of that square, I could reach to the thing to heal you, but I can't reach you.
I have gravely miscalculated this deal.
That's all I'm doing.
That's all you're going to do is second wind? Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Top one. I only do legit rolls, Austin, so no accusations. Don't turn into a frickin' Larry. 15 to hit.
Didn't hit.
Okay.
Now I just think you're favoring him.
Jorn, it's your turn.
Woo! How are you doing? If I can, I probably kind of see you. Oh wait, I couldn't see through the illusion. His illusion's a key.
But you know, there's an illusion.
I know, so. But I can't see him to see if he's like flying.
No.
You're gonna have to reach in there and try and grab him.
Reach out and touch someone.
If you can kill the ghouls, that'll work too. For now, there's only
yeah.
two of them, and I've hurt both of them.
Supposedly, you can reach around that corner.
Can I attack
that?
Can I shoot a shot at that ghoul that I'm kitty cornered to?
You can't see him. So you know it's fake, but it's still blocking your view.
You know how many AoEs probably not that would have reached there.
Yeah.
That would have toasted you guys.
I could have dodged it.
You did a good job of dodging the ghouls.
Well, so I can't sacred flame them because that one I have to see. The guiding bolt says a flashlight streaks towards a creature of your choice within range, 120 feet. This is a creature of choice.
I think you still need to be able to see a creature to choose it.
Okay.
I don't think you can be like, I know there's some kind of ghoul on the other side of this. I am focusing on the concept of the ghoul.
Yeah. Okay.
Just lean around the corner to hit him.
Well, it's a 5-foot cube, so that whole cube where Larry's character is standing is completely filled.
You said spell description is like a fog. Nope, that was a different one.
That was a different thing.
I was hoping that I could put a fog there that would allow you to walk through the enemy square to get past without getting an opportunity attack.
And then there's just a impassable wall, right? Like, you can't move into that space at all?
I mean, it's a 5-foot tall pile of rubble.
But we know it isn't.
Right. Yeah, we could move through it, sure.
So I could move in there and try to throw Larry out of that area.
Absolutely.
Yes, you could.
Larry.
Uh-huh. I'd say that would require, like, a strength check as your action to shove him forcefully out of the way.
Alright. I got +2 to strength. Why not try that?
Are you shoving me through the rubble?
into the ghoul?
No, like switching places with you. Although the ghoul thing would be more hilarious.
Okay, I'm going to try to grab him and throw him as a battering ram to the ghoul.
Okay.
Just because he announced it and it just feels right now. Sweet! I'm not going to do anything. Seven.
Yeah, seven's not sufficient.
I'm really hoping to see that.
Okay, so I can't do anything with strength. But I could move through there, couldn't I? And just say fuck it and break the illusion?
Isn't it just giving you advantage when they try to find the illusion again or something like that? Like, it doesn't break the illusion. Really.
Well, but he said when he's saying break the illusion, they would know that they're not really...
Yeah. He just stepped out of the rubble.
Rubble.
Yeah, I'll let you pass through. You know, Larry's paralyzed. He can't put up a fight, and I'll let you go around the corner, squeezing past that creature. But yeah, you have let them know that it's an illusion, and they're not, you know, they're undead, but ghouls aren't like zombie stupid. So they both like whip their heads around as they see you step out, and lick their lips. But I'll say trying to shove Larry, switching places with him, was your action.
Okay.
Alright, so this one on the bottom, it saw you pop out and it's hungry. Claws. 19 to hit.
Yep.
That is going to be... 4 damage, roll a constitution saving throw.
Twelve,
you're fine. That one is running, the next one is running. Minder, it is your turn. You're still paralyzed, roll a saving throw.
15!
You are no longer paralyzed, but it's the end of your turn.
Okay.
You're slightly disoriented because it seems like you're standing in the middle of a pile of rubble.
What the fuck's going on?
Does he get a check to see if he knows if the illusion is...
Well, he's kind of like standing in it, so obviously it can't really... Unless you're exceptionally stupid, you would know, like, I should be crushed and...
Isn't paralyzed like being in a coma, and I can see everything that's happening around me?
No, if I remember right, paralyzed is like you have no control over your body, but your mind is still functioning.
Okay, so yeah, so I mean, I would have seen Jason standing next to me casting that spell, right?
Yeah.
So, I know what's going on.
Yeah, because there's an unconscious... status.
Yeah. Alright. Coop.
Asandra, you're still casting a ritual?
I guess. I mean, is that something I can actively stop? I don't know.
Every round, I mean, yeah, sure, every round you're doing the ritual, you can decide whether you want to keep going or stop.
But that burns a spell slot, though, doesn't it?
No, that's alright.
Yeah, no, rituals, you can just do the ritual. The 10-minute cast time is what takes forever.
...in the spell slot, and then I incur the cost of the spell in the case of this. In the case of this, it takes a material that's expensive, like 10 gold. Well, I see that people have actually moved, and I might actually be able to do something, so I'm going to go ahead and stop the ritual.
Okay.
And I'm assuming that I can step forward and hit the one in the middle from one step forward?
Yeah, I'll let you do that.
Okay.
But he can't see through there. So I couldn't attack through there.
He has the ability to drop his illusion if he so chooses. But yes, that is a good point.
Yep. So as a free action, I'll drop my illusion.
Wouldn't the illusion have dropped when he started his ritual?
It's not concentration.
That illusion's not a concentration? Oh, wow. Okay.
So you just have as many of them as you want for as many spell slots you have?
It's a cantrip.
Oh, indeed. How long do they last?
10 minutes.
Wow.
No, sorry, 1 minute. 1 minute.
They could have just caved in everything around them. They'd be walking around
trying to find out. That's what I was trying to do. I was going to start at that middle square, and that's where I thought Lawrence was, but anyway.
But you weren't listening.
No, apparently not. I assumed they couldn't reach around the corner. I missed that part of the conversation.
They're the best kind of ghouls.
Well, these corners are quite magical in this plane. So I'm going to go ahead and cast Firebolt on the one in the middle.
Okay, go for it.
Take one of these Reacher ghouls with me.
And I'm going to miss completely. It's 6.
Domesticate. No, you miss.
I'm sorry, it's an 8.
Still miss.
We got Blowjob Mountain Reach Around Ghouls.
Oh, Tom. Tom has not heard of Blowjob Mountain.
Nor has Austin.
Oh, that was a classic.
That's in all its glory.
I've heard rumors of it and mentioned.
I coined that term, too. You're welcome, everyone.
The word triggers something in my mind, like I should remember it. But
he made this dice tower, and it was DM screen also. It was this mountain, and it's a volcano, basically. It had a hole at the top. And he could drop the dice in the hole at the top of the mountain, and they went down and came out the bottom. And Andy, from his perspective where the camera was, he called it Blowjob Mountain.
I said it looked like a mouth, like it was a fleshlight, so...
Yeah, I threw it in the garbage.
I felt really bad too, because he made it, you know, he made it by hand, and I made fun of it, and then like it was gone one day, and he's like, I threw it out. I was like, oh.
I think it looked good. I mean, I could see Andy's reasoning, but besides that, I really liked it. I miss it.
Oh, it was big and
unwieldy. That's why.
That's what he says.
All right. You see, missed the spell. Was there anything else?
No.
No? Okay. Galder, it is your turn.
I'm taking a swing at the one right in front of me?
Right in front of you. The one I have highlighted. Go for it.
Wow. One.
One? Yeah, one is not going to do it. Do you have any other actions that you'd like to do?
I'm staying right there.
Okay. So now it's that one's turn to return the favor. Where are you,
D20? Bring some spell.
16 to hit.
It's meet, right?
Yeah, meet or exceed.
Wow. Who wants? You know what's going to happen.
What?
Well, first the illusion broke. And then secondly, I dropped the illusion. And the ghouls get to attack before you.
Oh.
You're going to become paralyzed again.
No. Okay. So, yes, at 4 damage from the claws, and roll a constitution saving throw.
Fucking 24.
24, you're fine. Jorn. It's your turn.
My turn. Do either of these two ghouls ahead of us, one look a little beat down versus the other one?
Yes, the one that's below you guys looks quite a bit more beat up. Like one of its arms is kind of dangling down to the side as the chest area has been crushed.
I'm going to, since I can see him,
yep.
I'm going to shoot my Sacred Flame at him.
Okay, go for it.
Target must succeed a dexterity saving throw or take 1d8. Okay.
Sacred Flame doesn't have an attack roll?
Nope. Cantrip. It's not spell.
And what would it be 13?
Correct.
He did not pass.
He takes 6 damage.
Radiant damage.
Radiant. 6 radiant damage.
Check that. Yeah, with the divine radiance burning the flesh away from the bones of this ghoul, it falls to the ground, nothing but a pile of ash. And that one's running. And that one's running. I think they're half done running. Minder, you actually get to do something now. Amaze us all.
Do a barrel!
I'm going to cast False Life on myself. It's an at-will spell.
Okay.
No. 1d4 plus 4. I have 8 temporary hit points now.
I don't believe they stack.
I know.
Okay, that's the total? Okay.
I had 1, and then I rolled a 4 plus 4, which replaces it.
Okay.
So I have 8 now.
Alright.
And then... I can't move past the ghoul, can I?
No.
But I can move. I can move back away from him. Can I?
You mean back past Asandra?
Yeah.
Yes, if you want to, but you might take an opportunity to attack if you back away.
Yes, let's do that.
Okay. It sees you backing away. Out of the corner of its eye, and reflexively it reaches out to slash you with its claws. 8 to hit.
Damn it. No, it doesn't hit me. Can I walk slowly so it can hit me?
No.
Oh, it didn't move. Okay. That's it.
So you're going to move back behind Asandra?
Sup, ghoul! Yep, the format.
Asandra, it is your turn.
They went to get water.
Okay.
It's your turn.
Oh, it's my turn. With my turn, I'm going to shoot at the one in the middle.
Okay.
Just because... No, I'm not going to. I'm going to just use Firebolt. And that's a 13 to hit.
Let me check that. That hits.
Cool. Perfect. 8 damage.
8 damage. Yeah, that looked like it hurt it pretty well. It's got a big gaping hole in its stomach. Decaying flesh is starting to like leak out on the floor. Golder, it's your turn.
I'm attacking him. 20.
Yeah, that hits.
Two ones.
Didn't you
just
say
that?
Sixty damage. Yeah, you cleave this ghoul in half. And its body like flops to the floor and twitches a few more times before the unholy life leaves its corpse. In the distance, you can hear like the howling and the scrabbling of the two remaining ghouls. You guys have about 2 rounds before they stop being scared.
Yeah, one stand behind me.
Where do you guys want to arrange yourself?
I would say, let's move you back into the center.
And you guys just stand behind me and shoot past me, I guess.
Yeah, I'll switch places with the dwarf down there. He'll move into 29.
Okay, so he's going to move here. You're going to move here.
Yeah, and that way I should be able to see most our guys and I can heal from that.
Okay, what about Minder and Asandra? Where do you guys want to be?
Let Jason go one to the left.
Okay.
Can you just move him?
Yeah, because I can tip hit points tank one indefinitely. Yeah. Put me directly below Galder.
Right there?
Yeah.
Yeah, and I'm using the defensive thing.
Okay.
I'm with you.
What?
I'm with you.
In my kitchen?
Yeah. No, you're with the bathroom. They don't flush normally, and we were playing D&D one time, and Seth went to the bathroom and flushed, and apparently Wayne was like, "Oh, pooped."
Did somebody flush? Kathy's side of the family are all hippies.
Okay.
So they don't flush toilets.
Well, you should put a real world toilet in. That way it wouldn't be a problem.
Yeah.
Flush like 12 gallons of water.
It was just funny. I noticed that it was
yeah,
flush. Sometimes it's such like, a hazard for me.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. No,
it's official. There you go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, because Lane only associates dumps with flushing toilets.
Who had poop?
Oh, boy. All right, so after you guys rearrange yourselves and take up defensive stances, the ghouls return, rushing down the hallways to consume...
Opportunity attack.
Yep, sorry. Same here.
Okay.
Do you get two because of your stance? Because it's 10 feet away?
They need to move at least 5 feet within my range. So only the one on the right.
And I get attacked the one below.
So if you have the same ability as Austin, and one has to move 10 feet within his reach, how does moving into the 5 foot range trigger that ability?
I have polearm mastery. While you are wielding a glaive, halberd, pike, or quarterstaff, other creatures provoke an opportunity attack from you when they enter your reach.
Okay.
And within 5 feet right now is my reach.
Okay. Fair enough.
Once I upgrade weapons, I'd have fucked him up when he hit that X.
Alright, Austin, go ahead and make your attack.
I got a roll above 5.
15?
That hits.
Six damage.
Alright. Lawrence, roll your attack.
This doesn't count though, right? We're all.
Yeah, we already know what you got.
That's a 10. Much better than a 2.
Shut up.
So you missed.
Yeah, I rolled a 2.
Okay. Alright, so the first one comes up, swings, reaches back, and it's taken damage, you know, on one shoulder as it comes in, so it reaches around with the other and slashes at your face.
At your face?
At Austin's face. We're doing that one. That is going to be an 11 to hit. Alright, Minder, it's your turn.
That's cool. To attack tomorrow.
Yeah. Alright, so I'll go ahead and attack the one next to me.
Okay.
And that's a 20. 17 okay. Plus...
Wait.
Yeah. Attack roll is... Oh, plus 5. Yeah, so whatever. 17, 18, 19. Is that right?
It hits.
Attack bonus is your strength plus your...
Yeah.
Yeah, so 17 plus 5.
Yeah,
so I hit?
Yeah, that hits.
Alright, so then that, and then because I'm using a polearm, as a bonus action, I make a melee attack with the opposite end. But, okay, so I'll do that afterwards. So D8. 6, 7, 8. 9 damage.
Oh,
is it still alive?
Okay. Yeah, it's still alive.
Okay, so then as a bonus action... I'm going to attack it with the other end of my staff and miss.
Okay.
And then that was my attack. And then, okay, that's it.
All right, Asandra.
I'm going to firebolt the one to the right.
The one to the right, go for it.
That's an 11 to hit.
11 to hit. That does not hit. It blasts away rock from the ceiling.
And the ceiling caves in!
For real this time. No. Galdur, it is your turn.
Still attacking the one on the right.
Go for it.
20 again. Dice love me tonight. 18 damage.
Oh yeah, with a mighty blow, you cleave that ghoul in half from the sternum all the way down to his crotch. Like, split it right in two.
Not my reach around ghoul.
Any other actions?
That thing's dead, right?
Yeah, it's dead. Very dead.
Still see this guy there. No, I'm good. I'm just going to sit here and look badass, I guess.
Yeah. Jorn, it's your turn.
I can't see him.
That's true.
Oh, you know, can I still really have my turn and move out of the way so we can shoot that guy?
You're too busy looking like a badass. Badasses don't move out of the way. They stand there with their arms crossed.
That'll be my action.
Anything else, Jorn? Or is that going to be it?
Can I like, randomly just look that way while I dive through and run into them after the instantaneous spell?
Rolling? No, I'm not going to let you, like, power roll through the space and try and get something off in the midpoint.
Yeah, I'm just going to run into him then and just try to shove him out of the way.
Okay. Alright, he's standing there like a badass. Make a strength check to try and shove him.
Four.
Opposed to mine, or?
Yeah, let's say opposed to yours.
12.
Yeah, so you, like, just glance over your shoulder as he ineffectually nudges your back. It's kind of like massaging down your armor, actually.
How you doing?
Alright, the ghoul continues to attack Minder. That is going to be 14 to hit.
Yep.
You're going to take... 6 damage as it claws you. Make a constitution saving throw.
You take 5 damage.
Okay.
Cold. 18.
Alright, you're fine. Minder, it is your turn.
Is your ghoul not dead?
No, he's not dead.
Alright, I'm going to attack him with my quarterstaff.
Go for it.
And I miss. As a bonus action, I'm going to poke him in the eye with a blunt end. 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13.
That hits. Yes.
Finally got a word in.
D4. Now, so the D4 should also get the +3 damage, right? Because it's a weapon's damage die for this attack.
I don't know if that ability lets you add your weapon damage die or your
damage. It says you make a melee attack. And when a melee attack get... the damage bonus?
I'll let you do that for now, and we'll figure it out.
7 damage.
7 damage. It's teetering on its undead feet, but still standing there. Asandra, it is your turn.
Yeah. I rolled a 1.
Firebolt Golder in the back of the head.
Right.
All right, Golder, you're now done with your badass standing. It's your turn.
You can attack that ghoul, can't you? That's within my reach. I'll go ahead and do that.
Okay, go for it.
Okay, you're all looking at this, right?
Yeah, I saw you roll it. I saw you really trying to pick it up.
Well, then I put it down because I didn't want no one to believe me. 10 damage.
Okay. So what are you're using some kind of pole arm, right?
Trident, yeah.
A trident? Yeah. So you're using a trident? So you've got your arms crossed in your badass stance. You're holding your trident in one hand. And you lean over and you reach out and you just push Minder to the side. And as you're pushing him to the side, you don't even, like, look down the hallway. You just jab your trident past him and impale the ghoul, like, right in the frickin' face, destroying its, you know, its brain, and it just, like, crumples to the floor.
Cue the heroic Lord of the Rings. Shrink.
And then there's just like, what the hell?
I sat paralyzed for 3 rounds and I took no damage.
Because fake rocks fell on you.
We had a bunch of false life and temporary hit points too.
Yeah, I liked that. I liked that, that strategy. Alright, you guys have survived this ghoul attack. You're now in this hallway. The X's are not existing, but they are like mounds of dirt that have been disturbed as they crawled out of the ground. To your left, you see another T hallway, and you see hallways going to the right, bending off in the distance. What would you guys like to do? And how late do you guys want to play?
Just till 12.
Just till 12? You have 8 minutes.
Yeah.
To
decide. How are we on content? I mean,
what's up?
How are we on content? Like, if we stop now,
I'd say you guys get at least a good portion of another session out of the rest of this, out of Death House.
Okay, then maybe we should break now then before we get into another combat.
Okay.
Just because I got to work tomorrow.
Boo. Does Chris have to work too?
Yeah. What?
Does Chris have to work too?
No, he's going to be at the Beavers game.
Oh, fuck that. I'm going to stop recording because we're going to bitch about.